Now we have all the tools that we need to develop the SIFT detector. The SIFT detector was proposed by David Lowe and is very widely used in computer vision. And one of the things that it does is it uses a variety of tricks to make it both reliable and very efficient. So let's take a look at one of these tricks. It's an approximation to the N log operator. So here you see a Gaussian, N sigma, and if you subtract this Gaussian from another Gaussian with S sigma, that, it turns out, is a pretty good approximation to the N log operator with sigma, the same sigma here. So this is your normalized Laplacian of Gaussian operator. You get essentially very close to this, just scaled by S minus 1, but very close to this operator by simply subtracting these two Gaussians. So here you see the red curve is the difference of these two Gaussians for some S that's chosen. And the blue curve is the Laplacian of Gaussian, pretty close. So what that means is that the difference of Gaussian is just a scaled version of the normalized Laplacian of Gaussian. It's very useful because now rather than computing the normalized Laplacian of Gaussian, you can simply take your stack of images, which is just the original image smoothed with different sigmas, take any two consecutive images and find the difference between them, you actually get the result you would have gotten if you had applied the normalized Laplacian of Gaussian to the first of these images. Very convenient. So now let's see how SIFT is implemented. Here's an image. The first thing you're going to do is create a stack of images where you're applying smoothing with sigma, S sigma, S squared sigma, all the way to S to the power of K sigma. So that's your scale space right here. And now, in order to find the normalized Laplacian of Gaussian, which is what we're looking for, using the trick that I just mentioned in the previous slide that approximates it using the difference of Gaussian, you're simply going to find the difference between these two images. You get the normalized Laplacian of Gaussian right here, and you keep doing that to all pairs of consecutive images, and you get the stack you're looking for. So this stack right here corresponds to the normalized Laplacian of Gaussian of the image computed at many different scales. So now we need to find extrema in the stack of images. And we do that by using, say, for instance, you can do this in many different ways. You can use a small window, maybe a 3 by 3 by 3 window, a cube, a grid, and you're going to move this grid around, and at each point you're going to say, is this an extremum? Is this the largest value in the window? And is it substantially larger than all the neighbors? If it is, you can declare it as an extremum. So this also relates back to the non-maximal suppression algorithm we use for corner detection. There's many ways to find peaks in both 2D and 3D. In this case, we're doing it in 3D. Once you do that, you end up with these interest points. These are your basically candidates for SIFT features at many different scales. And of course, there may be too many of these because you haven't really cleaned things up. So what you can do is use some kind of a thresholding scheme to then just preserve the prominent, the really strong extremas. That's after removing all the weak ones. And now you have your result. You basically have your SIFT interest points. So what do these look like with respect to the image we started off with? Let's start with this one right here at this scale, the highest scale. Well, the position right here corresponds to the position right here. That's where you have a blob. And the size of the blob is proportional to the scale at which you are. So you have a fairly large blob right here. And this feature right here appears here. This one appears here and has a smaller characteristic scale. Therefore, it's a smaller blob, and so on. So if you wanted to visualize all the interest points that were computed in this case, they look something like this. There's a lot of interest points that have been extracted. And of course, you can use thresholds, et cetera, to reduce the number and only look for really strong interest points. But this just tells you that even for an image like this, you can get a lot of features from the image, SIFT interest points. Here are some other examples. So here's an object, and you see all the, every circle here is a SIFT interest point. And I just want you to note that not all of these are obviously blobs. We're looking at things that are blob-like, which have some interesting appearances within them. Here's another example, and yet another example. So we know how to find the interest points. We know their locations, we know their scales. So let's talk about scale invariance, because when you match these things ultimately, you want to remove differences in scale. So here is an example where you have an object and then a close-up of the object. You end up finding a SIFT feature here and here, which corresponds to the same appearance right here, but there are different scales. And since there are different scales, really what that means is that the n-log operator would have peaked at different points, different scales, different sigmas right here. This one peaks right here at a low sigma, and this one peaks at a much higher sigma. But because you know these sigmas, you can then normalize for this, meaning to say that you can adjust the scale of one to match the other. So in other words, all I'm trying to say here is that you can remove the effect of scale once you have detected one of these interest points. The other thing we need to worry about is orientation or rotation. So we need to remove the effect of orientation as well. For that, what we do is that imagine that this is, after the scale has been removed, this happens to be the area that the blob occupies. You can essentially place a grid in there. And for every pixel in the grid, you're going to compute the gradient. You're going to apply the gradient operator, which gives you the magnitude and the orientation of the edge in that, at that pixel. And we're going to completely ignore the magnitude and only look at the orientation, the direction theta. And the reason we do that is the magnitude, as you know, responds to or is affected by the lighting conditions, the gain of the camera, and so on and so forth. We want to make ourselves somewhat insensitive to those effects, and so we only look at the direction of the gradient. And now what we're going to do is create a histogram where on the x-axis you see different directions for the gradients, and here you see the bars correspond to the number of pixels in here in your feature within this region which have that particular direction, edge direction. And you see that you get a peak right here. And that peak is what we'll call the principal orientation of your feature. And so what this allows you to do is that when you're given two images like this, of course we're looking at the same feature here and here, it's the same interest point, this is the scale we're talking about, the size of it. You can compute the principal orientation in each case, and then you can undo the rotation of one to match the other. So what I've described thus far is the fact that not only can you find these SIFT interest points, but in each case you can also, during matching, undo the effect of both scale and rotation. But what we haven't yet discussed is, what do we match on the basis of? What is the signature that we want to use to match two features? And that's what we're going to talk about next.